IVM.
कृपया ध्यान दीजिए, the language used on the podcast may not be fit for consumption. We warn you, tread carefully. But listen, yaar, don't be so conservative.
Namaste, namaste. This grey goatee of mine is making me very happy. Actually, I'm just protesting against the lockdown. I will continue to protest. One man's voice against billions of others. I don't care what the populist tendencies are. Doesn't mean you all are right. All right. Every day we lose money. Every day we lose chances to make a life for our next generation. And while you may be getting killed by COVID, I don't deny that. I do think we should be allowed to go out there and have a society which is functioning, at least marginally, which it's not. Anyway, what I want to quickly rant about before we start our show, Cock and Bull, with our two August warriors who are standing by, or rather sitting. I was thinking, if they go on with this lockdown thing, since couples are having a little problem, you know, it's just too much, and seeing the same faces all the time, and it gets very monotonous, and familiarity breeds contempt, why don't we set up a little option, like a little game, where you can freelance with another spouse? See, this is not cheating or adultery. This is just that you can talk to, let's say, a Mrs. Parikh opposite and just have an interaction for 10 minutes. That's it. After which you don't have to ever re-interact again. I'm trying to work on this. I haven't got the whole blueprint out. But what I'm saying is, it'll just give a little spice to your life without you actually cheating. There's no question of cheating. You're just having a conversation. But I think everybody wants to talk to somebody else. They can't just see the same five faces all day. Okay? So let me get back to you with a proper one. If you have ideas on how this can be properly drawn out, please give them to us and we'll share it on our lovely podcast.
Want to learn something new and have a few minutes to spare? Well, then go for The Traveling Professor's Diary, where I, Siddharth Deshmukh, the traveling professor, will help you glean from all the insights that I've gained from wherever I've traveled, learned, taught, and repeated. Join me every Tuesday and Thursday on the IVM Podcast website, app, or wherever you get your podcasts from.
Let's start the show. It's called Cock and Bull. Silvery and Amit Doshi are standing by. Silvery has spent hours every night going through every single news report, rejecting nothing, and in 14 languages, 9 of them from abroad. And he has come back with 30 stories, out of which we'll try and do about 2. Silvery?
Yeah, cool. Yes, cool. Should we just get to the topic straight away?
How dare you be so abrupt? Yes, of course.
Yeah. I'm so caught off guard. This never happens. 2 minutes of the podcast started, it's getting...
Silvery, we have to at least act like we're working hard on this podcast. You can't act like three lafangas who hang around and wing it all the time. So let's just pretend that you've really done research. Okay, you've got that scholarly look about you with the glasses and the sweet, innocent smile. Wow, the Jugal Hansraj moment. Yeah, go on. Yeah.
I'm good at fooling people.
You are. You're a fraud, bro. Fraud. Yeah.
All right. So the first thing is coming in from Israel. A lot of the world has been praising Israel because they are almost fully vaccinated to the point they have removed their mask mandate. Restaurants are opening back up. People are flocking to restaurants. Beaches are open. Everything is open. Okay. Because almost 61.89% of their population, of their entire population, has already been vaccinated, at least single dose. And 81% of all adults above the ages of 16 have also been vaccinated. So, wow. Though that's pretty great. So
that's 2/3 of the population have already got and one vaccine is a proper, like, it's a vaccine.
It's your 75% like cover, yeah. Right? You're covered.
Right. So that's higher than any other country in the world, is it?
It is. It's like it South is, Bombay got vaccinated. Wow. That's the challenge, right? Same
number. You're making fun of the figure.
Yes, I am.
South Bombay is 20 million. Israel totally is 1 million.
Bombay is 30 million. Israel is like 9 million.
9 million.
9 million. There you go. Yeah. All right.
So it's like basically.
So you have Navi Mumbai in Israel? Huh? I mean, would that be correct?
I think Navi Mumbai might be a reasonable comparison. I think you can look at it as Bombay from, say, the tip to maybe about Bandra.
Yeah.
Right.
Bombay is about 1.25 crores.
Yeah. So everything short of the.
Do we include Dharavi in that? Or
yeah, we include Dharavi and Sion. We include Sion and Dharavi in it. But we don't include Ghatkopar.
We've already overtaken Israel. Yeah, we've overtaken Israel by my maths. Israel is far behind now. It's good. Yeah. They have to catch up.
Yeah, we have to take the central part of the. We have to take central part of the city as well.
It seems. it almost seems like a cheat, right? 90 lakhs seems like nothing. Why weren't they done sooner is the question.
Can you imagine what Uzzat Thackeray is thinking when he reads the article? He's thinking, why didn't I run Israel? 90 lakhs. How long would that take? Stay at home for 2 days and one night.
Yeah.
No, I mean, it's good that they did it and it's all admirable and all that, right? But at the same time, it's like people praising New Zealand. Right. I mean, like, it's great. New Zealand did an amazing job.
It's 4.75 million or whatever.
They did. So they're not even like, they're just Walkeshwar. They're not even like, you know, the rest of it.
Did they inoculate the sheep who are 40 million? That would have been a challenge.
That's true.
Yeah, that would have been 40 million. And it's difficult to find a nerve in a, you know, a vein in a sheep. Be careful. Yeah.
But they are getting some flack.
Who's getting?
Israel. So Israel, for the most part, for this vaccination thing, they've done a tremendous job. But
was it done in Mossad style, where you don't have a choice?
So they just went for speed. So people like related to like higher politicians or something, okay, you'll have to wait for your age group, nothing like that. High priority people, relatives also were able to like get, because they were like, we want speed. We don't want to be organized about this.
That's not a negative.
That's a good thing.
That's a system. That's a good thing. They worked out a system. Yeah. There's no corruption in that system. Yeah. This is the system they worked out. So if you qualify, it's like how when you board a plane, if your mother is old and say on a wheelchair, the five of us go with her onto the plane, right? They don't say only you.
That's true. Yeah.
So it's the same thing. I'm okay with that. You're
okay
with that?
Okay, absolutely.
I'm mostly okay with it because the point over there is speed, as you're mentioning, right? It's not about giving priority to people of like, this. Yeah. If you were looking to do speed in India, right, the way that you would approach that is you would basically start with urban conglomerations. You would go into like places where people are more likely to cooperate with you quickly, where people are more organized. And that's going to lead to slightly biased towards like, you know, wealthier neighborhoods in some ways, right? But having said that, I mean, like, you know, it's about speed, right? There, I mean, like 4 months in and they've got 9 million done. So I mean, like, that's admirable. It's good that they did it.
Absolutely.
I just feel like
it's we should look at it this way. The same thing about cleaning India. I had this blueprint in the 70s. I offered it to Indira Gandhi and she threw it out. I was four, of course. But the point is, if you localize, India can be cleaned very fast. If you localize, for example, in my lane of 8 buildings, if we just kept those 8 buildings clean, that's our thing. That's all we have to do. The next lane takes their 8 buildings. So it's a localization, and the federal system then works really well, but that discipline has to be fabulous, where everybody makes sure just their little area is clean. The same thing with the vaccine. So you take only our 8 buildings and we, the building panchayat or whatever you want to call us, make sure that those 8 buildings get vaccinated. The next colony does the same for them. His big buildings in Powai, whatever, 2-3 buildings are together, lots of people. That's their business and they have to get it done by themselves. Same with Walkeshwar. What do you think, guys?
That's how this would work, right? I mean, like, if it was, most other vaccination programs do work like this, right? Or most other medication or public health programs do work like that. The problem over here is that we're looking at a huge number of vaccines that need to be deployed in a very, very short period of time. And so, you know, I mean, like, it's one of the questions to ask, right? I mean, like, are we too centralized in how we've deployed the vaccine? It's something a lot of people are asking.
Yeah.
That should this have been more locally done? But they're not talking deployed. About like neighborhoods, they're talking about states and municipalities, right? Rather be devolved more over there. You know, I mean, like, it's an admirable idea, but at the same time, there has to be a dispersing authority, right? Otherwise, if there is not, Maharashtra and Gujarat would basically buy all the vaccine first, because these are the two richest states.
Punjab.
Right? Punjab, Karnataka.
Three. Karnataka, four. Telangana to some extent, five.
Yeah,
that's it, you're right.
The
bottom five will get nothing.
Exactly, wiped out. So there has to be a central dispersing authority.
Might not be a bad idea. No, it's terrible. Insensitive thing. I take it back.
But without a central dispersing authority or somebody to lay out priorities that this
on
goes
paper,
here, this
what
goes
you're
here.
Saying is correct. You need to have a central system, otherwise it's chaotic. Fair enough. But at the end of the day, then favoritism happens and the logistics don't work out equally in any way. In any case, it won't. It's just not possible. But it becomes more and more inequitable to everybody.
Absolutely. You know what the magic is to fix all of it, Cyrus? Like, there's a magic formula.
Yes.
Competence.
And sincerity.
Yeah. Just some degree of competence in terms of, like, how you plan this. Some degree of competence in terms of, like, you know, looking, just thinking about this. This will solve the problem. Whether it's centralized or localized, competence solves all.
Here's the question. We are 1.3 billion almost. China's a little bit more than that. Mm-hmm. But they're doing better. So, obviously, there must be a Or they're not telling us everything. That's always
They're 100% not telling us anything. And they are doing better also. But they also have a
totalitarian government, which allows you to push the envelope. Yeah,
exactly. Which allows, the lockdowns that they had in Wuhan, right? And it's not come back in Wuhan in any major way since, at least from what we hear. But the lockdowns that they had in Wuhan, I mean, like, they make everything that we did look like child's play.
Yeah.
Right? It was literally, you are not allowed of your house. Okay? One person is allowed of the house once a week to go out and buy groceries. That's it.
Yeah.
And this was what they did for 6 months. They did this till May of 2019, right? 2020. They did this for 6 months, man. There's no way.
So what you're saying is that we're pretty spoiled complaining about Maharashtra government, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. When if we had been part of the Beijing government, we probably would be happy to go back to Maharashtra.
Well, if we were part of the Beijing government, then we would not be doing a podcast on, like, you know, all the things, right? I mean, like, you know,
pretty praising the government, yeah.
Yeah, you know, I mean, like, we'd be doing, like, good for Beijing. You know, they're amazing. Yeah. They're great. We'd have been the pucks.
It would have been called the Communist Party podcast, and it would have been very popular. I wish we had done it. Can you imagine 1.6 billion Chinese people listening to our show and a few Indians? And now what do we have? 20 people isolated in Maharashtra who hate the lockdown, who want to join me. My small band of merry men. Robin Hood giving vaccines to the poor, stealing from the rich. Come here. Yeah, give me that. Mr. Shah. Yeah. That Mr. Shah is just a generic reference. Huh? Amit, let's be very clear. Kripaya dhyan dijiye, that is a generic reference. Just took a common name.
Very common name. But you know what's another common name? Amit's another common name.
That's true.
It's my name.
It's very common, really. Unbelievably common. Yeah, true.
Yeah, there's one more part about this though. So again, for the most part, Israel has been getting a lot of praise about this. But there are parts of Israel-occupied Palestine where the vaccine has not been reaching and Israel is not even considering that a priority. The cases are on the rise, mortality rate is on the rise there, but they're just not getting vaccines in those regions, which is, that is...
Which has been their foreign policy or whatever you want to call it for many years. Nothing's changing.
Yeah, but again, those are...
Well, not really.
Isn't that what everyone's doing? It's first for myself. Yeah. In US withhold sending us vaccines last week with their whole song and dance.
No, but once again, Israel still controls Palestine.
Part of it, right?
Yeah. And it is as unacceptable for Israel not to be deploying. Dude, you just threw water on this whole story. I no longer admire Israel. Now
you've got to be careful. You say this, then look at India and Kashmir.
Kashmir,
I would say
also.
We just stay away from there because, you know, it's then we've got the same thing going in our garden.
We do have
the
same thing.
You can't really point fingers at somebody else.
But it's
unacceptable
in our country either, right? I mean, like, if vaccines are not, Kashmir's health situation is disastrous in many ways, right? They have the least doctors in populations and stuff like, least doctors per 10,000 population and things like that, right? Compared to any other part of India. So, I mean, like, it is as unacceptable, right? So, I mean, like, listen, we have not gotten to the point right now where the Kashmir thing is outraging us about the vaccine distribution. We are still in our own little, in our own kind of arena.
You know, this is a global world. You know, we've reached a point when you have a pandemic, it's exactly that pandemic across the world. And it makes no sense to me to get jingoistic and nationalistic and protective and exclusive in your thinking beyond a point, because you're not solving anything. You're just pushing things a little away. It has to stop all over the world, otherwise we're still going to be screwed. So in a sense, it makes no sense in the long run to have this attitude about only for mine. Mm-hmm. You know, it makes no sense. It has to be a global effort. In many cases, it is a global effort. And I think people have to look at it that way. And there's no point if Israel doesn't leave that minority population of theirs aside like that. They do come in contact with us. It's going just from a clinical point of view, not a moral point of view.
This was one of the, way back when, Cyrus, when we were recording out of famous studios, Mahalakshmi, right? I mean, like back then, I remember we had an argument over this, or an argument or a discussion or whatever. I mean, like back then we didn't argue, we just discussed, right? Mm. What is the value of the nation state in today's world?
Yeah.
You know,
has it seen its time? Yeah.
Has it seen its time? Is its time gone? Right. And I do think that, you know, we're you know, it's the idea of a world government is scary to some, but I mean, like, if you want to see the kind of equity that you're discussing here, you need a federalized structure the same way you have a federalized national structure. You need a federalized international structure, right? Because that's how you can target, that's how you can deal with an issue of this nature. It's not happening. It's not going to happen today. It's not going to happen in the next, but 100
this
years.
The pandemic is a wake-up call to a lot of people to realize that there are no boundaries, right?
Yeah.
I mean, it sounds so cliche saying, oh, I can kill everybody, age, race, weight, height, sex, gender, what, makes no difference. The you know, you can still get the pandemic. But that actually, the cliche is true. Because, you know, at the end of the day, it just makes a mockery of all the divisions.
Yeah.
And thereby proving that we're wasting our time.
Yeah.
We can't just keep Thane safe. You're just trying to keep Thane safe. It's pointless. You're only going to get 2 weeks of happiness and misery after that.
Yeah.
Because we can't. So if Israel doesn't turn to its corners, left, right, and center, and say, okay, got to help whoever's there as well, it's just going to come back to hit them. I'm just saying from a clinical point of view, forget morally. Just think practically and clinically and say that the whole world has to hold hands, sing kumbaya, light a candle, and take the vaccine together, and everybody's got to get it. Otherwise, tell me, if two countries keep it going, this damn thing is ravaging. It's like a fire.
It's there.
Boom, boom, boom.
It's there. It's not going anywhere.
And if idiots like us know that, then I mean, you know, the scientists must be just shivering with fear. I can just see with, you know, better knowledge of how terrible the situation is.
No.
Recently came out. Dr. Fauci has said some good things about the vaccine manufactured in India, saying that it's a very effective version of the vaccine.
He gets 10%, Silvery. He gets 10%.
But just a random mention of scientists made me think of Dr. Fauci praising our Covaxin.
Did he pronounce our scientists' names properly?
I don't know.
I mean, being a Parsi, the name was a little, you know, tongue twister. You still say Aadhaar because the Aadhaar card is too much in your head. And my good friend Kunal goes on shouting at me because he thinks he's this great Parsi because he lives in Baman's house now. And it's Aadhaar, And, you know, which to me, when a Parsi says it, the H goes out and becomes Aadhaar, like the cow. So I just, you know, it's all over the place. So, yeah. So I think that would be fun because Fauci's name is a little tongue twister.
Yes,
Firstly, when you read it, because you don't know the Italian, the double C becomes Sir.
Yep.
Why do the Italians do that? Double C should not be Sir. I mean, it doesn't make any sense. CH?
Yeah.
Okay, Amit, can you call up an Italian and ask them? This has been driving me mad for years. Double C. Sure. Why?
That's interesting. Is it only Italian words?
Huh?
Is it only Italian words?
Maybe Latin languages.
No, because if you look at, like, see, in English, occasion is double C, but that's O-C-C-A. So that's a hard C.
I think an I ending in I, maybe. Avicii.
I'm just trying to think, like, where does the double C turn into a soft C?
Don't let the Italians off the hook.
Is it all the Italians only? Is it only Italians?
I've seen the
reference. Do they still have those sailors?
My little knowledge of opera and things like that, the double ch is a real headache when you're pronouncing the words, etc.
Hmm.
So the double C becoming ch, I'm saying.
Okay.
Once you know it, but it still throws you because it doesn't make logic. There's no logic to it. It's like I mentioned yesterday, the H in Hrithik or Rishikesh, our lovely Rishikesh there.
Yeah.
Why is there an H there? And somebody says, no, but there's a very soft H. I asked Gopal, actually, who's a Hindi pandit here, Sanskrit, he has a vague knowledge. And he says, there's a soft H in the Rishikesh. Can anybody say it for me?
Rishi.
I tried.
Rishikesh.
It begins with a small H and then there's the R, which...
There is a difference. Isn't there R versus R?
Yeah, it's... I can't do it. Can you do it?
Rishikesh versus Rishikesh.
No. Just do the R.
No,
you sound stupid. I'm sorry, mate.
Okay. Maybe I do. I can see it. I do see that. I mean, like, but then again, everybody calls him Rishi, right? So nobody... Yeah, that does not have the H.
Rishi also keeps an H. Our Rishi works, who's there somewhere listening silently.
Yeah. Right? So most
Rishis keep an H now. Maybe in the old days they didn't, but off late I've noticed.
Really?
Yeah.
Rishi Kapoor?
So, no H there. But I'm saying that 90s onwards, you find that the H is there. So someone,
but that's because,
you know,
90s onwards, we went into this thing where all names have to be like this hardcore Sanskrit, Adarya, and like, you know, those kinds of names, right?
Yeah. So when you spell it in Hindi, how do you spell Rishikesh in Devanagari?
I would think
call that boy online right now.
Is he on?
Because I have to do this.
Okay.
Rishi, are you there?
Yeah.
Can you spell Rishi HRI in Hindi in Devanagari? Her. Is there a her before the R?
Just give me 2 minutes. I will No. I will show you how I spell it in Marathi.
Oh,
okay.
Marathi is good enough. It's also Devanagari. That's fine. Yeah. And now a lesson in linguistics.
Like a lot of people, like messed it up during even school times.
I can imagine. Like, it's strange. I'm not disrespecting when, it as long as there's a reason. Give us a reason.
No, it's strange when like people from outside India spell my name correctly and like Amazon and delivery then, guys like say Harikesh. Like Harikesh. There is no E. Like my family gets confused. Like we don't have any Harikesh in there.
Okay, so we're waiting. I know it sounds like we've gone into a sort of petty small issue from Israel and COVID and global pandemic.
We are all about those petty small issues.
No, it's not about petty small. We have to clear our minds. That's what the podcast is all about. Let's just leave things in the air if we can. We have a Rishi, thank God. You know, and it came from Fauci. We can't get a Fauci. If we can, if there's anybody listening who's Italian or whatever, please come on for 5 minutes with us and freewheel about the pronunciations and explain the Fauci thing, etc. And what the reason is. Now he's not going to give us a reason, but he's at least going to spell it in Devanagari. So then we have a, not phonetic, what is the right word? Alphabetic reason to it. And then maybe we can try and pronounce it. God, what if our Galis had an extra word? You can't say MCBC anymore because there's a K before it or something. I mean, God, you just lose your confidence in a fight. You'd be like, idiot. God, ouch.
There's like a lot, man, in terms of how you are supposed to pronounce a C in Italian. I'm just
looking at... Can you share it, please?
I can screen share it, but it's a Quora answer, which is kind of insane. I mean, like, I'm just looking at it, it's like a full freaking page.
Well, if we can't make head or tail of it, we'll give up, but... Yeah.
All right. Single C okay. In front of an
okay.
A, O, U, H, or any other consonant is a hard C.
Okay.
So all words where C is followed by H E or H I is hard.
Okay.
So C H I E S A is pronounced Kisa.
Okay. I'll explain in English. So if this word C H E E R cheer becomes seer.
Becomes kier.
Okay. Which becomes kier. Becomes kier. So I care for you. In Italian is I cheer for you in English and it's totally different. Okay.
Yeah. And double C, so basically we pronounce Tai Chi and not Tai Ke, but it would be Tai Ke in
Italian.
In Italian.
Yeah.
But the double C is slightly longer. So it's slightly longer. It's more accentuated like when you sneeze or very similar to the phrase gotcha. That ch is similar. So it's not ch like chair.
Soft.
But it's got a T in front of it.
So is it hard or soft?
It's got
a T in front of it.
It's a T. Yes.
Cha. The cha.
Yeah. Oh. So D-O-C-C-I is doctor. And okay. E-C-C-E-Z-I-O-N-E is eccezione.
Eccezione. I was born with that.
Eccezione.
Eccezione.
When followed by an A or a U or an H, A-O-U-H or any other consonant, the double C is hard again. So M-U-C-C-A is mucca.
Oh, okay.
So if you did something illegal in your exam, you're a keter.
You're a keter.
You're a keter.
So you're a keter.
Yeah. But and if I wanted to give a girl a puppy, how would I say that? K-I-S-S becomes
I'm just trying to think. K is, there's no this, right? There's no C in K-I-S-S.
So there's no kissing in Italian.
There's no... There's
so much for the language of love and all that nonsense. Lies, I tell you. Oh, lies. Celery, I hope you learned something, bro.
Yep.
Yeah. How complicated is linguistic thought sometimes, especially when you don't see the logic. I see when you see the logic, like in bodybuilding, sometimes some of the titles are so simple. Like, you know, what they are is what they mean. And people don't understand that, you know, like a deadlift is literally lifting something dead from the floor. That's all there is to it. It's no great logic. So I like that linear logic for the simpleton. That makes me happy. When that doesn't happen. By the way, Rishi just walked out.
No, Rishi, yeah.
He's going to write it and he's going to send us a photograph, no?
No, Rishi, it says me, no?
Yeah.
Rishi, don't do a thesis. It's a five-letter word in Devanagari. Maybe six, depending on how you want to interpret it. But honestly, we're holding up a bloody live show here by our night. People are watching. I'm like, what the hell is going on? They were just in the middle of Israel-Palestine politics.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, it is.
Oh, so it's this is, one. Okay. That is, yeah, it's that fancy.
That's a very clear
hell.
Yeah. But that's an R-I, like... in Hindi.
That's Hara.
That's Hara.
Hara.
How do you pronounce Hara? Yeah?
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. Okay. I mean, that's interesting. So it actually sounds much better in Devanagari. I mean, it seems to make a little bit more sense. And when you put the H in English, I mean, because we give it a more pronounced H, you know, when you see it. Yeah, we don't have a half H option in English.
Also, that letter is the coolest looking letter there is, right?
It is. You have to have a certain intelligence to write it.
Yeah, there's no letter in English or Hindi that looks cooler than that letter does.
I thought the letter F followed by U and then a couple of other.
That's a combination of letters.
That's a
no, I'm trying to spell Fauci, my guys. Come on. And don't you speak Italian? Comprende? Oh, that's Spanish. Sorry. Maybe Italian. Who knows? All right. Can you get away from this, guys, and go
yes,
back to
yes,
our
yes,
yes, yes, yes.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to another great week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank the sponsors on the network this week, thewholetruthfoods.com, Seat, PayPal, and Cred. We thank you all for your support. Tune into The Note, where Maru Kanaya talks to Dr. Bipin Joshi about the second wave of COVID. He calls it no less than World War III. On The Habit Coach, Ashton was joined by Yoshita Dave, who's a sex educator and intimacy coach. On Paisa Vaisa, Anupam Gupta was joined by Amit Thakkar and Hiral Jain of Market Pulse Technologies, and they talked about trading in Indian markets. All Things Policy by the Takshashila Institute had on board Mihir Mahajan and Pranay Kothasthane to talk about the recent changes in the Indian intellectual property front. You should definitely check out the Cyrus Says episode with Ace Casting Director Mukesh Chabra. They discussed some of his best work. We also had Ira Mukoti, who has authored various books on history and mythology from a female gaze. The IPL season is in full swing and we have Edges and Sledges in English and Khel Niti in Hindi if you want to check out cricket content. Really, really great conversations on both of those shows. Do check those out. And with that, let's get you back to your show.
Follow me at Instagram and Twitter on Bored Brocha. I'm so bored, I need your help. I need your love. I need your touch. Okay, just follow me.
Recently, I think in the last few hours, I'm not sure, Amit will have to tell us the exact time frame because he sent me this. But the hashtag resign Modi was blocked on Facebook, like properly blocked where you couldn't.
By Facebook.
Yeah, if you search for the hashtag, you would just, nothing would show up and Facebook would say that it's been blocked.
Would they do something similar? What happened with Trump? Just remind me.
So Trump got...
Trump.
Yeah, they blocked him off completely. Over here, this is different. This is so we.
You're taking a political stand. I'm saying of sorts. Yeah.
No, so they're not taking a political stand per se. But the thing is that our government is notoriously thin-skinned about
this. It's a fear thing.
Yeah. It's about COVID response. No,
the government must have complained. They're not putting it off without for no reason.
So once again, if I complain to Facebook that you are being abused by XXX, they can pull that out, right?
So they it's do. A lot harder, but they do.
If I'm a high profile guy, say it's Shah Rukh Khan or something, and I say so and so person is trolling or whatever, they can pull that out, right?
They can, but they won't do it for trolling and stuff like that, right? They'll do it. So there's a threshold that has to be crossed, right? And the government of India's threshold is something along the lines of content which will create disunity, and it's a whole act, man. I can't remember what the exact terms of it are, but it's basically stuff which can foment violence or that.
Okay, in that act, is it two C's or one C?
Act is one C. I
don't know because of Italian, my mind is blown. I have no idea, man. Atched. Attached. Who knows what it is? Yeah.
No, but what happened over here is that basically, for whatever reason, resign Modi as a hashtag was blocked on Facebook completely. And it's just a series of things that we're seeing, like from this, right? Blocking people talking and complaining about COVID, right? There were the 50, 60 tweets that got blocked by the government. And the thing that strikes me as so insane over here, right, is that the government is being, the thinking behind this is so weird, right? Because they cannot stop Facebook from publishing or Twitter from publishing the same stuff in the rest of the world. All that they can do when they put a notice is say that you are not available in India.
Also now, get so much publicity because you've done that everybody outside is checking it out.
Yeah, what's going on? There was this BBC interview yesterday, which was like Veer Sanghvi tweeted about, right, with some BJP spokesman. And the guy came off as such an idiot because the woman is like, but you're a democracy. Are you immune from criticism? Do you, I mean, like, can you not take a little criticism when people are, when an MP, a sitting, how do you block the tweet of a sitting MP who's saying that the Prime Minister has done a poor job on this? You can't do this, right? I mean, like, it's insane that you would
try to block. Democracy is a concept. If you can't criticize, critiquing is 80% of democracy. I mean, you have to have a voice. Having voices is what democracy is all about anyway. What's the point? We've discussed this.
So here's the thing though, right? I mean, like, I have disagreements with the government, right? But I've never criticized. I've always thought that they've been effective from a communication perspective. But this stuff is so...
So in your mind, you've been fair and balanced. When it's good, it's good. And when it's not good, it's not good. You're not... axe to grind kind of situation where I just call him out. I can't, you know how guys are waiting to catch people?
Yeah, I'm
that's
not
prejudicial. When you hate someone and just waiting to catch them. But
I don't think I'm like that. Who knows?
Yeah, I don't think you are. Honestly, I don't think you are. I'll give you a pat on the back for that, Amit.
Okay.
You're pretty clinical in your thought when it comes to that kind of thing.
Huh? But the thing over here is that this is such a dumb thing, because what happens is you block it in India. It's not blocked elsewhere in the world. Now, other people from around the world, it's not like we don't have access to what they're saying. Right? How did I find out about this?
Just gets repassed to something else.
Yeah. How did I find out that Facebook blocked this?
Yeah.
Because Raju Narisetty, who is a fairly well-known tech journalist, tweeted about it, that Facebook in India has blocked Resign Modi. And he's put a screenshot up. Now I know exactly what was said. How did I find out what the BJP MP said? Because somebody else in the UK or in the US put a screenshot of his tweet and tweeted that. And I saw it. So you can block this stuff. I don't understand the point of it.
Listen, I've been on television since 1995, 96. Every year people tell me to resign. Okay? And I never stopped them. I've never even gone up to them and said, don't say that. And I'm talking about my own parents. I've never said it. So I don't know what the big issue is here. You've got to get a thick skin if you're in public life and just let it go sometimes. You know, unless it's really personal. You know, you're abusing your mom, dad. No, I can understand it. Cross the line where it's just barbaric and savage and not civilized. But a civilized dissent, one has to live with it as far as I'm concerned. Otherwise, you just kill the idea of democracy and you're not. And we go back to being Stalin's Russia. And you dare write anything against them and you're going to be going to the gulag forever. You know, which is not where we are. We're still a democracy. And I would think, like I've been telling everybody who asked me questions in this Amazon rush for our show called Laugh Out Loud, we aren't allowed to talk about politics. They don't let us say anything. They want to err on the side of caution. Fair enough. It's a show. It's a funny show. I don't get into that. But if you want to critique people, sometimes you just have to be more innovative. You know, I think that's the key. That's where satire helps you. I'm not saying we get it right at all, but I'm just saying it gives you a chance. Because otherwise people also, what's the point of abuse? Like, I don't like Resign Modi. I think he could have done it a little better. You make your point that he's not doing a good job according to you, but this is so basic that it doesn't turn me on, you know, to read. There's no wit, there's no prose, there's no turn of phrase, there's nothing funny about it. And sometimes you can just do it correctly, even the one who's criticized will have a smile, you know?
Yeah, well, this is a hashtag, right? So it's part of a larger post and, you know, you're trying to talk around it. So there are some posts with the hashtag which are not that bad.
I'm not supporting the central government. No? It's not like I'm a big supporter. But I don't think I want to be one of those hostile witnesses either, because I think that makes no sense after some time.
Yeah,
for the sake of it, because it's cool. Yeah.
There are, so I have a number of friends who are like, you know, well, I have a number of friends who are pro, but I also have a number of friends who are extremely anti.
That's democracy.
It is, but I mean, one of the things that you're seeing in this country, right, which I don't think was really there up until like a few years ago, was like the tribalism around politics, right? I don't feel like it was there when over the last, I've been politically sort of kind of aware since like maybe the late 80s, right? Like when I was late in school. I don't feel like it was like this.
And
like
the media power putting and the either fear or power putting or whatever you want to call it, psychofancy, that really has come with this cult.
Yeah.
You cannot deny that. It's never been there before. Maybe they're saying in Indira Gandhi's time for a little while because she was very powerful. But, you know, I didn't live in those times. So I can't verify. But there's no question that the muzzling or the psychofancy, that they prefer to choose that path for safety or whatever, that's there. And that is a little mockery of democracy. And that's a bit sad. What do we do?
It's not just media though, right? I mean, like it's heightened amongst people who are just people who I know.
Regular. The word regular. Huh?
Yeah. But I mean, like, you know, it's heightened among them as well, right? That I mean,
but
like
Silvery's parents are very pro-BJP. He himself is not.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's a healthy sign, I would think. In a sense,
yeah, I agree.
You know, it is one family you can be divided. Gopal, who's working with me here, is very anti-BJP. He wants to bring the government down. He's communist. He has no friends. There are. Just like the tiger, there are about 3,000 communists left. So please go and embrace them as soon as you can. We'll take a quick break and
let's do our cred ad.
Oh, we should do a cred ad.
We must keep doing cred ads.
I'm sure I'll have a cred ad somewhere. The Cred Maker Jackpot Week is... I've got it. I'm ready. Rishi, stay unmuted. You'll enjoy this one. Rishi with an H. We'll get Gopal to tell us the whole story. He's the Sanskrit Pandit. He can speak Chaser. In fact, he has no girlfriends because he insists on calling them and talking to them in Sanskrit. Well, Uma Bharti also spoke in Sanskrit once, but they're not of the same age. Not that I'm suggesting. The Craig Mega Jackpot Week has got me way too excited. For this, I need someone to show an excited face. Yesterday, we had a lovely one for
Amit. I'm excited.
Amit, I like your nonchalant excitement. From 3 years of free flights, 3 years of free flights, to winning a new Tata Safari car, there are tons of prizes to be won. You can even win free iPhones for the next 10 years, which means I'm going to pay for my daughter Maya's 6 monthly phones. Although I'm trying to figure out a second-hand market also in case I don't win on Cred. Yeah, Cred Mega Jackpot Week is from 27th April to 3rd May. New jackpots will be received every day and crazy offers from partner brands on specific dates. So don't miss out. Just download, everybody.
Cred.
Kya baat hai?
I know.
Almost like Sanjay Leela Bhansali has made this video, you know, shot it beautifully. The colors, the people, the talking, the song and dance, the camaraderie, the bonhomie. Wow. Cred. You brought us together. You brought India together. Cred and, well, the pandemic, but in different ways completely. Yeah. Topic. Do we have time for topics?
Yeah, yeah, I think we can.
So let's go to AMAs because we get a lot of AMAs and we usually are never able to get to most of them.
No, we don't. Yeah.
So let's...
Kachin Shetty and all have to get there 5 minutes.
Yeah. he has had quite I think 3 questions already.
We should just let him come to one of our houses.
Yeah, correct. Okay, the first one I want to read comes in from Anahita Pillai. She has a two-parter. She says two things.
Anahita
Pillai.
Should be Anahita. Okay. That's very Parsi. Anyway, go on.
This is Anahita. Anahita is, I think, Parsi. A-N-A-I.
Anahita is Anahita. Very Parsi. Anahita alone, just A-N-I-T-A, could be anybody. That's more like a Spanish
word. Okay.
When you go into Anahita and Anahita and all, that's very Parsi.
Okay.
Anyway, whatever. Right. We don't know now. We wasted 20 minutes on Rishi.
Okay. Now,
10 minutes on Anahita. It's your call.
Okay, quick.
Cred is walking out. Cred is walking out.
All right. Anahita Pillai asks two things for Cyrus to rant about. One, Maharashtra is likely to extend the lockdown at least till May end or till the vaccination 15. Goals are met, which will help the state prevent a third wave of the COVID. And point number two, Uttarakhand has wrapped up Kumbh and are preparing SOPs for Char Dham Yatra in coming months after assessing the COVID situation in the state.
Well, they've got a spotless record. I suppose it should go smooth. Right now, Uttarakhand should start counting whatever's left of their population as the dispersal happens. From the sites of the Kumbh to various parts of Uttarakhand, MP, UP, Bihar, Jharkhand, and all the neighboring states, all the way down here as well, I'm sure. So we'll see the after effects of that. It's going to be fun for everyone. Coming back to the lockdown, guys, it's up to the 15th. Why are we going 30th? That'll be just too much, man. What is this?
I hope it doesn't go that long.
We have an MTV show, which has moved from the 5th, gone again up. Now, we're losing not just money. I'm getting older. I can't work on new channels. Every 6 months, there'll be a repetition. The guy's too old. You know, come on. Everybody else is 16. They've got iPhones, iPhone 14 or whatever. And I've got this thing with a puppy on top. I don't even know what it is. I mean, really. Look, Amit, put your hand up now about this. Now, stop taking a government side. How many days do you want lockdown?
Lockdown. I'm perfectly okay with the lockdown being this, right?
I mean, you have measures. I'm saying give us 6 hours a day or whatever. 50% office, you know, do some sort of compromise.
So
we can't target, just sit at home.
Again, competence, right? Targeted ways of dealing with this. And we're not dealing with this in targeted ways. Our government will basically let everybody do everything they want to whenever they want to, or they will let everybody do nothing. Right, there's no sense of targeting measures, and this again, it comes down to competence, right? It comes down to devising a way that you can make people as safe as possible, but at the same time allow them to do what they need to do as well, right? And I mean, it's just allow. Can't believe I'm using the word allow.
But once you come at numbers coming down, okay, because you stay at home and don't test, okay, which is another sort of like a fake thing, in a sense. A lot of people staying at home, so there'll be no less testing happening,
right?
Because people may be getting it, but staying at home or whatever. That's one. Two is when you let them out, will there be another surge again? Because we've not really gone towards immunity. We've just gone to hiding.
Well, there's always...
So it doesn't disappear, right? Does it disappear? Does it just take off?
It doesn't disappear.
Say, okay, Istanbul tonight? What? No.
No, so the idea is that you bring the numbers down by this lockdown measure. And then when you bring the number down, then after that, when it starts climbing again, or if it does start climbing again, it climbs slower because you get people to start taking measures again. But the thing is measures...
You're talking about infrastructure and stuff like that, getting the beds back in place and the oxygen cylinders and all, which we don't have, and the vaccines haven't yet.
So that was the initial phase. Now we're not at that phase. Now we're at a phase where people are just panicking right now because people are... dying because the healthcare has collapsed, right? So, I mean, I don't know, man. I mean, like, I don't want a lockdown. I'm frustrated with the lockdown. But I don't know what to
think of the daily wage earner. Think of all the guys who are just absolute. You know, we are actually still okay in a sense that our lives will not break yet.
Yeah.
You know, but there are lots of people whose lives are on a day-to-day basis, on a weekly basis. How long can they go on?
It's impossible.
And all the way up to businessmen who've taken loans and are stuck.
No, people are screwed. People are screwed. I mean, like, the number of people who are having to restructure loan payments and stuff like that. I mean,
my friends, Kunal and Gopal, have got a sponsor for a street play. I think they've got some 1,000 rupees sponsorship already that's been on the table for some time now. And they can't do anything on the street.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you know, I mean, Gopal's actually dressed for it. I mean, I wish I could show you. And, you know, I mean, this is the response of the public. He went out for a little while and the public was so happy to see him. And he said something about, mujhe vaccine pasand nahi hai bilkul or something. The next thing we know, this is what they did to him. Yeah. Actually, written a gag on an astrologer. I think we discussed it here. We discussed it with somebody on this, which really blew my mind. No astrologer predicted the pandemic. They didn't really. Yes. And no one predicted the second wave. Okay? So much for that. That industry has to shut down now. I mean, that's just ridiculous. Ridiculous. So I've written a whole gag only on this guy getting beaten by everybody because he didn't predict. You know? I mean, it's just too big for you not to predict. You can't tell me that
you know
he will do well in exams this year. Ah, fuck off. What the hell? You missed the pandemic? The stars were not showing that.
You know, if that's the end result of this, where astrology is no longer...
It's a slap for astrology.
Well, it's not...
You'll be happy. You're the rationalist. You'll be happy.
No, I mean, like, astrology is bullshit, right? So, I mean, like, it's not a slap for astrology.
Well, they say it's a science.
Well, yeah, it's a science. It's a
astronomy is a mathematical science. Astrology is not.
Astrology is bullshit, right? Yeah. Astrology believes that 1 out of 12 of us, or basically...
Well, it's...
Yeah, no, astrology is bullshit, man. There's no...
No, but they say they base it on the movement of the stars and all, don't they?
Well, they can base it on whatever the fuck they want to, right? But what they're doing is they're imparting... basing it on the movement of the stars is no different than basing it on the movement of the birds or basing it on the movement of, like, you know, the waves in the sea or basing it on the movement of the...
Bro, if you're a sentry, at the border, Arunachal Pradesh border, and you don't see the Chinese troops coming, I mean, you know, how can you get this job again? You'll never get this job again. The same thing with astrologers. They're holding a prediction and you miss this prediction, the biggest prediction of the entire... generation, 20 years, 30, I can't think of World War II, probably.
But
since the whole world has been hit.
This is an amazing thing for all the rationalists to go out and like beat the non-rationalists with, right? Over and over.
Why
again.
Should I go to the astrologer? Yeah. I'll be like, what are you going to tell me about who I'm going to marry? Who cares? Yeah. You couldn't tell us what happened when 10% of the world's population got killed or something. I mean, what the hell?
That should be the first question. Did you know about COVID?
Yeah.
And it's not 10%.
You know there's a third wave in 3 months. Yeah. What?
It's not 10% of the world's population.
Please, I don't mean that. You know, we have to exaggerate. It's satire of some sort. We exaggerate.
Yeah, but I mean, like, when you're exaggerating to 10% of the world's population, that's...
Listen, it's our black tongues, you know. You're right. I strike that off the record, my lord. I ask forgiveness of the global world.
Sorry, talking about astrologers, did you ever, by chance, meet Behzad Daruwala?
He's come on our show. We met him many times. Unfortunately, he passed away in this mess.
But he's
very much a friend of this thing. I followed the column, Jagjit Upal, growing up.
Yeah.
I don't know if Amit remembers. There are 2-3 astrologers in our English language newspapers that were always there. Very prominent. Even the...
Remember Bijan
the American ladies. Linda.
Linda Mayer, Linda Morris.
Yeah, famous one, yeah. Because being Leo and all that, somebody gave that to me for my birthday. So I started reading her also after that. Okay. Because whatever you say, you get a little intrigued because everywhere you look, you'll find a 30% acceptance of that quality set. I mean, if I went into bloody Scorpio, I'll find 30% acceptance of the quality set. Actually,
I read a really interesting thing in a book once, right? Where somebody was talking about tarot. Right. And how tarot is useful as an analytical tool and not so much as the astrology parts of it are kind of bullshit, right? Which all astrology is bullshit. But
we really touched a nerve with Amit. Huh.
Yeah, yeah, no. I'll
send you the link of our gag. You'll like it, huh?
Okay. But so the way you look at tarot is, right, there are a bunch of cards and each of those cards have like attributes which are assigned to it. So the guy was using tarot as like a gaming mechanism. So you're attacking a problem, you look at the card that you have and then start considering the problem from the aspects which are within that card. Right, like death implies change in tarot, right? So you start looking at an issue and thinking about when the death card comes, you start thinking about, okay, how does change apply in this situation? And it acts interestingly as a gaming mechanism, right? But that's not astrology. That's just, you know, you can do that with anything.
Guesswork, yeah.
You do that with a list of characteristics.
And also, I don't get the whole generic prediction, you know? It'll be a good year. It's a good year, bad year, that's all over the place. If it's not specific, what are you getting out of it? You know, he should get married this year if the stars align. I mean, what? That's not an answer.
But here's the thing. The stars are going to align or not align. We already know this.
Yeah.
If the stars align, is like...
No, but they always give themselves a way out, right? If you listen to the conversation, especially when it's in Hindi, you'll be able to understand that it's always ambivalent actually by nature.
I know.
But you're getting what you want to hear. And that's what you'll take out.
That's how astrology works, right? I mean, like, you hear what you want to hear out of it. But when people say, like, you know, that's one of the lines about astrology that people use sometimes, which really makes me laugh. If the stars align, because we know exactly what the movements of the stars are going to be going millions of years in the future, right? And millions of years in the past.
And the best part, Amit, bloody William Shakespeare, the smartest one of them all, in the same play gives you both options. Because Cassius says it is the stars that govern our condition. And Brutus says the fault, dear Cassius, lies not in the stars, but in ourselves and the underlings.
Yes.
So both versions in the same play. So he just leaves it out there. F you. Everything is correct and everything's incorrect. Oof. Really. The big question is, man, master of his destiny. It all comes down to that or not. Yeah. We'll just never really know, will we?
Are you guys aware of this? Yeah. So the US government at some point, the CIA, used to employ psychics. Just after the Second World War, they were employing psychics to, like, basically keep themselves ahead of the Russians and all that. Are you aware of this?
I have heard of that, but it's another example. It's another example of nonsense and bullshit.
This actually happened.
But they did it. But they don't do it anymore, do they?
No, they don't.
Yeah, the reason why is they figured out it didn't work.
Yeah, obviously.
All you need is to be confident. That's all you need for this job. It's better than politics, actually. Which is also all you need to be confident. But here you just have to wing it all the time and sort of give them an answer which is 80-20. 80 in their favor, 20 against, so that you have that pull out.
Cyrus, I think your next year is going to be a very interesting year. You're not going to be able, you know, you're not, the kinds of things that are going to happen to you are going to be things you've never seen before. You must be prepared for change. You must be prepared to experience new experiences.
Will I finally grow chest hair?
Cyrus, I think the stars are not aligned to, for that.
Sir, wo nahi bata sakta hai, sir. Pluto kehte hai ki nahi, magar Rahu kehte hai ki sahi. Yeah, God.
Okay.
Wow. Chalo, boys. Next, sorry.
I want to know this. What do you guys think of hypnotism?
But that's different. See, that's more like a craft.
Yeah, it works.
I've seen it happen. So I've seen people get hypnotized and they do get hypnotized. Have you seen it live?
I've seen it a number of times. So I think the hypnosis works, mind control does not, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
Right? So you can hypnotize somebody to, like, you know,
they go into
a
trance.
Yeah. They'll go into trance. When they wake up, you clap your hands and cluck like a chicken. That stuff can happen, right?
Yeah.
But you can't tell somebody that go and kill somebody or transfer all your money to me.
Yeah.
Right? That's not great. So mind control doesn't work, but hypnosis as a thing works, right? And it's actually supposed to be super effective for, like, therapeutic things, right? Quitting smoking.
Yeah. Smoking, drinking, all that. Yeah. But again, they don't know more than that. It's more like a talent, like a cocktail party talent to put up for 20 guys to watch.
Yeah.
You know, it's like a little show. There's nothing more to it. This is not like you're going to solve world economic policies with a hypnotist. It's not going to happen. But with astrology, on the other hand, as you said, asking so-called psychs to come and discuss foreign policy and how to be ahead of Russia and all. I mean, this is the most rational country of its generation. Very odd. But then it just appears that human beings all live in hope. Isn't hope a place in America as well? Arkansas?
Yes, it is. That's where Bill Clinton was born.
Correct. There you go.
I come from a town.
The audacity of hope was actually about Clinton, not Obama.
So that was Bill Clinton's, like, I think, speech at his convention, that I come from a town called Hope.
Yeah.
That was his line.
He must have used it all his life, you know.
That's a good line. Yeah, that's a good
line. It must have been used by three generations before. I mean, everybody, you get a name like Hope, you know. I wish my town was called Screw. Oh, it is. Okay, what's next?
So we have a funny topic suggestion from Sid DA. He says, I just looked this up. This is very, very interesting. A public sector worker described as the king of absentees by the Italian press is said to have broken the national record by allegedly skipping work for 15 years.
He doesn't need a lockdown. This is the hero of Uddhav Thackeray and the lockdown specialist. Yeah.
Dude, and
15 years, he kept the job.
Yeah, he kept the job. Police say the hospital employee, he was a hospital employee. Police say the hospital employee continued to be paid salary. A monthly salary of 538,000 euros every month, despite not turning up to work. Yeah.
538,000 euros a month.
No, that's the collective. That's the collective score. But it comes. Come on. Yeah,
euros a month.
It doesn't say a month.
This collective score.
It must be over the 15 years.
But hello. Here's the point.
Okay.
And you know what 538,000 euros are, Ankit? That's 6 crore rupees.
Silvery, there'll be benefits.
Okay, no.
There'll be benefits. He's working in a hospital. There'll be benefits attached to it, medical and others. Not just the money. Anyway, the point is that instead of saving lives, he saved his life. So in a way, he's still done that, you know. But how did they not fire him? Is something not to be asked of him?
So he's now being charged. He's now aged 67 years old. And he faces charges of abuse of office, forgery, and aggravated extortion.
So, he forges attendance. So it was a proper...
He did definitely forges attendance. Yeah.
Italian jugaad, which is spelled J-U-C-C-A-D. Okay.
But how is this different from the municipal workers that we had who used to hire people to do their jobs?
They did, but it wouldn't extend for 15 years. I don't go without...
Dude, there were people attending. Who did it. Not without once attending. Without once attending.
They would use it. They would not abuse the system, if I mean.
No, they would abuse the system, but they would
use it judiciously.
Yeah, they would do it a little smarter than that. They'd show up for team meetings and stuff like that.
This is why the Indian cheat is always better than the Italian cheat. Italian cheat doesn't understand how to draw the line. Because cheating also has an art. It's got its ups and downs. You've got to figure it out, the formula correctly. A lot of respect for Indian cheats, honestly.
So, very interesting as to how he did it. It says, in 2005, the man is alleged to have made threats against the hospital director to stop her from filing a disciplinary report over his absenteeism. The director then retired and the man's absenteeism continued unabated because his attendance was never checked by the director's successor or the human resources department for 15 years.
He threatened the person.
The great thing is that because nobody saw him, as the years went on, it played to him, played to his side.
Out of sight, out of mind.
So you don't know he exists. So that's not a problem for the newer generation that's running the hospital because he just doesn't exist. The thing is that somehow the salary would go. So in accounts, he must have had somebody who was known to him or there has to be some alliance there.
As well, 100%. You can't do this by yourself.
Yeah.
It's not possible. When I wanted to bunk college, I had to bribe the pune Kale at HR to make sure that my attendance
was marked. And it was still easy in our times. It became more difficult.
50 rupees a month.
Yeah.
50 rupees a month, he would make sure that I was attending like about 70%, 75%.
Kale owns 10% equity in our IVM now. He's been with you every step of the way. Aaj Kale or Aaj Kale. All right, guys, squeeze one more fast.
Yeah, let's do one more.
Okay, sure.
I'm just looking at this. The astrologer's name was Linda Goodman. I was just looking at the chat as well.
Thank you. Okay. Linda Goodman.
Go ahead, Antariksha.
Girl gave me that as a birthday present. Go on.
All right, next one comes in from Kashin Shetty. Hi, Kashin.
You know, there's another question over here the end of the chat. This one comes from, this one comes from Narasimhan Khandri. How much money does Silvery take from Kashin Shetty?
How much money do I take
from Kashin? Kashin has to become part of IBM.
He's
like the Italian hospital employee. We don't see him, but he's there for the last 15 years.
But go ahead, Antariksha.
Yeah, all right. So Kashin Shetty, after bribing me, has asked this question. How do you guys deal with neighbors who wait for you at the stairs and the moment they see you, they unload their worldly problems on you? Can't even abuse them because age.
Bro, I've discussed this so many times. It's all about the lift evasion. The lift evasion is a philosophy where you pretend to really like your neighbors, but if you see them or they see you, you tend to quickly get into the lift and not share it because you don't want to share your space. We all do that. The one neighbor who doesn't do that, there are one or two in every colony or area or whatever, those are to be worried about because they really are lonely. And you're right. I have one guy in my lane who just comes and starts talking. He's just waiting there, even during lockdown. And he asks ridiculous questions like, you're not shooting your show? You know, just pointless questions like that. Uh-huh. And he just won't take no for an answer. He just hangs with you like you know, like a wart. So, yeah, it does happen. I agree with the writer, the caller, the texter, whatever you want to call it.
The bribe.
Okay, 10:50. Right. Last question, we have to go.
Okay. This one comes from Jehan Daru Khanawala, which is very close to Bejan Daruwala. That's the name wise. What are the odds?
Not really, but well, okay.
Jehan Daru Khanawala? It's quite. Okay, he says, hello, Cyrus, Amit, and Silvery. For AMA, he says, in the Valentine episode this year, Cyrus said that he was sleeping facing Aisha's feet and the lockdown situation improved it. Has he stopped
doing that now? I started when Netflix film happened, finally. Yep. That's when I started because that's the first load of money that came in. And the Amazon show that we're doing, this LOL, which is releasing on Friday, which I should have publicized, anybody else would have, but I didn't. That happened. So then little money started coming in, work started coming in. Then Amit's thing got bought over.
Yeah.
That was another good, you know, godsend. So I had 3-4 things happened in the space of about actually a month, in 1 month. By chance, now after all our astrologer bashing, after all the sense about irrational people, oh God, I'm finished. I have no face to show.
The superstition. By chance,
yeah. And all the shit started happening. The money started coming in, the world started getting better, the lives are getting better. And I was sleeping. I said that to get the AC draft actually on me, on my head, because it was feeling really hot in October. And I started sleeping there. And then I said, oh God, I can't stop. And there you go. There's the psychics in America who create foreign policy. I salute you. I have been like that ever since. And, you know, inshallah, the work still comes in and all that carries on. So now I can't break the cycle. I can't break the chain. Udav, I can't break the chain. Amit, I'll give you closing remarks. After 25 minutes on all these interactions.
I don't know what to say because, superstition is superstition.
Tell me the truth, guys. If something works for you, then you'll end up wearing the same pants.
It does.
The same belt or the watch or whatever. I don't know. Looking that way when it happened. Come on.
This is
horrible, but true.
You're 100% right. I mean, like, but I've been able to identify something which would develop into a superstition for me. I'm sure I have them, but
we had no work for 5-6 months. Nothing was going our way.
Yeah.
It was the longest run.
Honestly, I was
thinking of doing other things. You know, should I become a real estate broker? I don't know. And all that. And then suddenly work started coming back. What could I do? It all happened in the same period. I'm trying to think, it's not more than 30-day period where all these things have three big things happened.
Yeah.
And then other things, smaller things happen also. What was I supposed to do? It's got to be karma, man.
Yeah. No, that's true. I don't know.
Linda Goodman.
I don't know, man. I mean, see, this is the thing, right? When rationality, when it fries in the face of this kind of stuff, right? It becomes really tough for you to this, right? Like, how do you argue with the athlete who wants to wear his clothes in a particular order before he goes out to play?
Oh, God.
You can't argue with that, right?
First, you know, I mean, God, really.
Yeah, but here's the thing, Cyrus. You can't argue with that because a big part of performing at a high level is also establishing routine, right?
So what we should tell it? Yeah. What we just tell everybody out there is that we're a bunch of shit.
Yes,
we don't listen to anything we have to say. Right? We don't make any policy decisions.
What is the line? Consistency is the mind goblin, something like that. Consistency is for idiots.
Yeah.
What is that? It's a really, really cool quote. Like,
oh, let's put this: we are idiots for consistency. It doesn't mean we do it. You know,
hold on, like that. I'll find you the quote one second.
I have to go and work.
Huh. This is from Ralph Waldo Emerson. A foolish consistency is the hobgoblin of little minds, adored by little statesmen and philosophers and divines.
Well, I don't know where I fit in, but I'll just say this. If I land up sleeping face to face with my wife, my life sucks. Okay. Bye, guys. See you tomorrow. Bye, everyone.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Bye.
Okay, catch us on any of the podcasting apps, please. We beg you, we need you. Send us your questions on Twitter on Cyrus Says In, or you can email us, even if you're not female, on whatcyrussays@gmail.com.
Is a difficult year. A global pandemic, protests, elections, recessions, you get the picture. What we need is a space where we can have nuanced discussions about global affairs and foreign policy. That's where I come in. My name is Hamsini Hariharan, and I host the States of Anarchy podcast. Every second Tuesday, I speak to experts in the field of international relations to make a little more sense of the world. So join me on the IVM podcast app, website, or wherever you're listening to me right now.
Working Monday to Friday, glued to your chair, making you feel dull? Worry not. Get your 5-minute weekly dose of travel around the world with Postcards from Nowhere. Join me every Thursday as I explore the strange, obscure, and fascinating parts of the world and bring out facets of travel you may not have thought of before. You can find us on the IVM Podcast app, website, or wherever you get your podcast from.